Hello students, in this video we will discuss the last part of the story The Verger by William Somerset Maugham. Already we came across the part where Albert Edward Forman was working as a verger in St. Peter's Neville Square for 16 years. He was very hard working, dignified. He always considered the verger's position to be a very dignified one, and his conduct was always good. His work was always satisfactory, but in spite of all his good qualities, he was dismissed from the job of the verger. So let us start from that part. Today actually I have prepared a paraphrase along with the text so that you can understand the things more clearly. Okay, so let us start. Yes sir, I quite understand. I shall be applied to and in my resignation as soon as you have found somebody to take my place. But when Albert Edward with his usual politeness had closed the church door behind the vicar and the two church wardens, he could not sustain the air of unruffled dignity with which he had borne the blow inflicted upon him, and his lips quivered. He walked slowly back to the vestry and hung up on his upper peg his verger's gown. He sighed as he thought of all the grand funerals and smart weddings it had seen. He tied everything up, put on his coat, and hat in hand walked down the aisle. He locked the church door behind him, strolled across the square, but deep in his sad thoughts he did not take the street that led him home, where a nice strong cup of tea awaited him. He took the wrong turning. He walked slowly along. His heart was heavy. He did not know what he should do with himself. He did not fancy the notion of going back to domestic service after being his master for so many years, for the vicar and church wardens could say what they liked. It was he that had run St. Peter's Neville Square. He could scarcely demean himself by accepting a situation. He had saved a tidy sum, but not enough to live on without doing something, and life seemed to cost more every year. He had never thought to be troubled with such questions. The vergers of St. Peter's, like the popes of Rome, were there for life. He had often thought of the pleasant reference the vicar would make in his sermon at Evensong the first Sunday after his death to the long and faithful service and the exemplary character of their late verger, Albert Edward Forman. He sighed deeply. Albert was a non-smoker and total abstainer, but with a certain attitude. That is to say, he liked a glass of beer with his dinner, and when he was tired, he enjoyed a cigarette. It occurred to him now that one would comfort him, and since he did not carry them, he looked about him for a shop where he could buy a packet of gold flake. So Albert Edward Forman, after he was told by the vicar that his services were no longer required in St. Peter's Church, Albert was deeply involved in his thoughts. Okay, so he was deeply indulged in deep thoughts. He was deeply involved in his thoughts. He was very sad and pensive, and he took a wrong turn. Instead of taking a correct turn, he took a wrong road actually. So let us go to the paraphrase of that part. Now see, Albert, when he was told by the vicar that his services were no longer required as a verger, Albert Edward, he went out of the vestry and he politely closed the door. Okay, after he stepped out, he politely closed the door, and though he maintained his dignity in presence of the vicar and the church warden, so he was very dignified. Okay, he did not quiver, he did not show his impatience in front of the church wardens or the vicar. He didn't show his weakness, or he didn't show his impatience in front of them. Still, after coming out, Albert was so much troubled, or he was so much affected that he was shaking like anything, and he was very upset at that point of time. Okay, he was very upset. Now, being immersed in sad thoughts while walking home, he took a wrong turn. He did not know what he should do regarding a job. Now, Albert Edward Forman, he was so immersed in his sad thoughts because he was dismissed from the post of the verger where he was working for the last 16 years, and now he was jobless. So he didn't know what to do with his life actually. He was deeply immersed in sad thoughts, and while walking home, instead of taking the correct road, or instead of taking the usual road, he took a wrong road. Okay, he took a wrong turn. He didn't know at that point of time what he should do regarding a job because he was jobless at that point of time. He was jobless. So Albert was jobless at that point of time. He didn't know what to do regarding a job now. Okay, because you need to have a job in order to run your life, in order to earn a livelihood, you need a job. But Albert didn't know what he should do regarding a job. And moreover, he could not go back to domestic work. Okay, Albert could not go to domestic work because after working in the domestic sector for many years, okay, he was able to get the job of the verger, which he was doing very well without the knowledge of reading and writing. But when he lost this job, he could not demean himself. He could not demean his position by going back to domestic service because he had worked for so many years as a verger. And although Albert had some savings, because it seemed that Albert was a very practical man, he knows how to actually save money. So although he had money, he knew that it would run out soon because life seemed to cost every year. Okay, life seemed to become costlier every year. So Albert could not run on this savings, or he could not live on this savings for a long period of time. He had to do some things to earn money. Okay, to earn an income, to earn a stable income. And he had never thought about this situation. On the contrary, he had imagined that he would continue as verger till his death. Now, if you look at the explanation here, okay, if you look at the explanation here, it is given that Albert often thought of the pleasant reference that the vicar would make in his sermon at Evensong the first Sunday after his death to the long and faithful service and the exemplary character of their late verger, Albert Edward Forman. So Albert always thought that he would never bother himself with thoughts like finding a job or running jobless, because he always thought that he would work as a verger in St. Peter's till his death. And he always thought that his work was so satisfactory, his character was so exemplary, that after his death, the vicar would give a sermon and would make a pleasant reference to the late verger Albert Edward Forman. It means after the death of the verger Albert Edward Forman, the vicar would make a pleasant reference to his exemplary character. So this shows that Albert always thought that he would continue as a verger in St. Peter's Church. He never thought that he would be dismissed from the job. And at that point of time, Albert was feeling very tired. Okay, why he was tired? Because his mind was full of all such kind of thoughts, like what to do to earn a livelihood. And he was thinking about all the grand funerals and weddings in St. Peter's. He was feeling very, very sad. His heart was heavy. Okay, his mind was full of sad and heavy thoughts now. So Albert was feeling very tired and exhausted. And whenever Albert felt tired or exhausted, he would actually smoke a cigarette to comfort him. And at that point of time, Albert was feeling very tired. And therefore, he wanted a cigarette to comfort himself. Okay? Now, let's go to the next part of the story. All right. Now, it occurred to him now that one would comfort him, and since he did not carry them, he looked about him for a shop where he could buy a cigarette of gold flakes. He did not at once see one and walked on a little. It was a long street with all sorts of shops in it, but there was not a single one where he could buy cigarettes. "That's strange," said Albert Edward. To make sure, he walked right up the street again. No, there was no doubt about it. He stopped and looked reflectively up and down. "I can't be the only man as walks along this street and wants a fag." Fag means a cigarette, he said. "I should not wonder but what a fellow might do very well with a little shop here. Tobacco and sweets, you know." He gave a sudden start. Then an idea. He said, "Strange how things come to you when you least expect it." He turned, walked home and had his tea. Now, in this part of the story, now see, Albert was actually wandering about in Wansa Street. Okay, he took it because he took this street because he was so deeply involved in his thoughts that he took a wrong road actually. And while in this road, he felt so tired and exhausted because of the different kind of thoughts that were coming to his mind that he wanted to have a cigarette. But as he didn't find any, he suddenly an idea occurred to his mind. So let us go to this part. So Albert, he was looking for a cigarette shop or a tobacco shop. Okay, he was looking for a tobacco shop. Albert was looking for a tobacco shop to buy a packet of cigarettes, because usually Albert used to carry a packet of cigarettes, but on that day he didn't have any. And as he was feeling very exhausted and tired at that point of time, he felt the necessity of smoking a cigarette, and he looked for a shop to buy a packet of cigarettes, but he could not sight one, and walked further, but he did not find any. And he thought that he should actually go a little farther to find one, but he didn't find any. It was a long street with all kinds of shops. So this particular street where Albert embarked on by mistake was a long street with different kind of shops, but there was not a single one selling cigarettes. So there was not a single tobacconist shop in this street. Okay, it was a street with different kind of shops, but not a single one is selling cigarettes. Albert found it strange and he checked it again. So Albert, in order to assure himself, he checked it again. There wasn't a single shop selling tobacco. Now at that point of time, Albert actually came across a sudden idea. Sudden idea occurred to his mind. So he reflected that a person with a small shop selling tobacco would be able to do well. So Albert, he thought that this particular street where he had embarked was actually a place with not a single shop of tobacco. So he thought that a person with a small shop selling tobacco would be doing wonders, okay, would be making a lot of money, because there is no competitor to give him competition. So the person would be doing a lot of profit. He would be doing wonder if he opens a tobacco shop in this particular street. So he wondered about how things come to a person suddenly when the expectations are least, because at that point of time he lost his job as a verger. But now he was wondering how ideas come to a person suddenly when expectations are very, very less actually. Now reaching home, this particular part took place. You are very silent this afternoon, Albert, his wife remarked. I'm thinking, he said. He considered the matter from every point of view, and next day went along the street and by good luck found a little shop to let that looked as though it would exactly suit him. 24 hours later he had taken it, and when a month after that he left St. Peter's Nevada Square for a while, Albert Edward Foreman set up in business as a tobacconist and news agent. His wife said it was a dreadful come down after being verger of St. Peter's. But he answered that you had to move on with the time. The church wasn't what it was, and henceforth he was going to render unto Caesar that was Caesar's. Albert Edward did very well. He did so well that in a year or so it struck him that he might take a second shop and put a manager in. He looked for another long street that had not got a tobacconist in it, and when he found in it and a shop to let, took it and stocked it. This was a success too. Then it occurred to him that if he could run two, he could run half a dozen. So he began walking about London, and whenever he found a long street that had no tobacconist and a shop to let, he took it. In the course of 10 years, he had acquired no less than 10 shops, and he was making money hand over fist. He was making lots of money. He went round to all of them himself every Monday, collected the week's takings and took them to the bank. So Albert, he got a sudden idea when he was wandering about in this street, which he took by mistake. Okay, so he was so deeply involved in his thoughts that he took a wrong road, he took a wrong turn. But when he had the necessity of smoking a cigarette, Albert was looking for a shop which was selling cigarettes, but when he didn't find any, he thought that a person would be doing well if he could open a tobacco shop in this corner. Now reaching home, Albert actually considered, considered the matter from all aspects. So he was considering the matter from all point of view, okay, and he was not a person who would waste his time in useless thoughts. He never used to postpone things, okay, because you can see that when he was working as a verger in St. Peter's Church, he would be doing the work that day itself. So that day there was a christening ceremony and he had to tidy up the church. He never used to neglect his duties. So when he got this opportunity of opening a tobacco shop, he didn't waste this. He immediately took the opportunity. So next day itself, Albert went to the same street and he took a little shop on rent, and he took it. And after a month on leaving, St. Peter set up in business as a tobacconist and newspaper agent. So Albert immediately took a shop. Okay, he took it on rent. He staffed the shop with all sorts of tobacco products and other products. And then after a month of leaving St. Peter's, he was no longer jobless because he set up in business as a tobacconist and newspaper agent, and he was doing very well in business. Okay, and in a year's time, so within a period of 1 year, his business was doing so well that it made him think about taking another shop and entrusting the runner of it to a manager. So Albert, he was doing so well in business that he thought that if he could do well so well with one shop, then he could take another shop and can put a manager in it. So he did the same thing. He searched for another street, okay, without a tobacco, this means without a tobacco shop in it. He found a shop, he took a shop on rent and started his business there. So Albert repeated the same thing in another street where there was not even a single tobacco shop. So he did the same thing with that particular place too, and it was a success too. And Albert was a person who had a lot of worldly wisdom and experience. He was not going to stop there, because when he was working as a domestic servant, he didn't stop only as a page boy. He got promoted in his life. So the same thing took place when he started his business, because after starting two shops, he thought of further expansion, and in 10 years, Albert was able to open 10 shops, which earned him a lot of money that he deposited in the bank. So every Monday, okay, Albert, because it was not possible for him to look after all the shop, so he used to entrust these shops, or he used to appoint managers to look after the shops. And every Monday he used to go to these shops to collect the money, and he deposited the money in the bank. Okay, I hope that till this part it is clear to all of you. Now let us go to the next part of the story. Only a little bit of part is left out now. All right. Okay. One morning when he was there paying in a bundle of notes and a heavy bag of silver, the cashier told him that the manager would like to see him. He was shown into an office, and the manager shook hands with him. "Mr. Foreman, I wanted to have a talk to you about the money you have got on deposit with you. Do you know exactly how much it is?" "Not within a pound or two, sir, but I have got a pretty rough idea. Apart from what you paid in this morning, it's a little over 30,000 pounds. That's a very large sum to have on deposit, and I should have thought you would better to invest it." "I would not want to take no risk, sir. I know it's safe in the bank." "You need not have the least anxiety. We will make you a list of absolutely gilt-edged securities. They will bring you in a better rate of interest than we can possibly afford to give you." A troubled look settled on Mr. Foreman's distinguished face. "I have never had anything to do with stock and shares, and I would have to leave it all in your hands," he said. The manager smiled. "We will do everything. All you have to do next time you come in to just to sign the transfers." "I could do that all right," said Albert Sartre, "but how should I know what I was signing?" So what's given here is Albert Edward Foreman thought that he would be able to do very well by opening tobacco shops in places where there was not even a single tobacco shop. So he started to open tobacco shops, and within a period of 10 years, he was able to open 10 shops, not less than 10 shops. And on Monday, he would be collecting the money from every shop, and he would be taking it to the bank to deposit the money. But one day when he was going to deposit the money, he was asked to meet the manager, because the manager was going to advise him on certain aspects. Okay, so one day when he went to the bank to deposit money, the bank manager spoke to him. So the bank manager wanted to meet him, and when he was shown to the office of the bank manager suggested that as the money deposited in the bank was a huge amount. It was a huge amount of money, and obviously Albert was not going to get a better rate or a good rate of interest for that huge amount of money. So this manager advised Albert to invest his money in stocks and securities, in share market. Okay, But Albert Edward, he was an already all of you know that Albert Edward Forman was an illiterate man, so he did not want to risk his money by investing in stocks and shares. And he thought that it was better to keep it safely in the bank, like all his money would be safe in the bank itself. But the manager said that they would do the investment on his behalf. So the manager told Albert that he need not worry and that the bank would do all the investment on his behalf. But he had to just sign the transfers. He just had to transfer the money. He had to put his signature. But Edward at that point of time, he replied that how would he know what he was signing? Because all of us know that Albert was an illiterate man, isn't it? Albert was an illiterate man. He didn't know how to read and write. But the manager didn't know about it. And he was asking Albert to sign some papers. But Albert told that he could not trust because he didn't know what he was signing. Because he didn't know how to read. And the manager pointed out that he could first read and then sign the papers. Alright, now we are coming to the last part of the story. Alright. Okay. I suppose you can read, said the manager a trifle sharply. Mr. Forman gave him a disarming smile. Well, sir, that's just it. I can't. I know it sounds funny like, but there it is. I can't read or write, only me name. And I only learned to do that when I went into business. The manager was so surprised that he jumped up from his chair. That's the most extraordinary thing I ever heard. You see, it's like this, sir. I never had the opportunity until it was too late, and then somehow I got obstinate like. The manager stared at him as though he were a prehistoric monster. And do you mean to say that you have built up this important business and amassed a fortune of 30,000 pounds without being able to read or write? Good God, man, what would you be now if you had been able to? I can tell you that, sir, said Mr. Forman, a little smile on his aristocratic features. I would be verger of St. Peter's Neville Square. So Albert Edward Forman, he was asked by the bank manager to actually invest his money in stocks and shares, to invest his money in gilt edged securities. And the manager told him not to worry about anything because he just had to sign the transfer paper so that his money could be transferred to all these stocks and shares. But Albert was worried because he didn't know what he was reading while signing the papers. And at that point of time, Albert revealed to this bank manager that apart from signing his name, he could neither read nor write. And the manager was so shocked to know about this that he jumped out of his chair. Okay, and he wondered what Albert would have achieved if he was literate. Like Albert could amass such a huge fortune without the knowledge of reading and writing. So this manager wanted to know what he would have done in his life if he would not have been if he would have been a literate, if he would have been a person who could read or write, then he would have done wonders in his life. So Albert had a smile on his face at that point of time, and Albert, in a very, you can say, in an ironical manner, in a very humorous manner, he told that if he would been a literate, he would have been the verger at St. Peter's Church. Like, or if he would been a literate person, then he would still remain the verger of St. Peter Church. He would never become a successful businessman. He would never become a successful tobacconist or a newspaper agent. He would remain a caretaker or a verger in St. Peter Church. So you can say that this is actually mocking at the society, who always determine the worth of a person on the basis of the education of the person rather than his qualities. So similarly, what happened when Albert was working as a verger? He was doing his work satisfactorily. He was a hardworking person. He was a dedicated employee. He was working his job in a very dogged manner. But still, he was dismissed from the job of the verger because the vicar and the two church wardens thought that being a verger of St. Peter Church, the person should be educated because it would increase his efficiency as a verger. Education would increase or enhance his efficiency as a verger. Okay, it is important to do his duties well in the church. So the same thing took place with the manager of the bank. he also had the same kind of mentality. He thought that if Albert could earn so much of money without education, then what would be Albert if he would be a literate person? And Albert, at that point of time, with a mocking smile on his face, with a smirk on his face, he just replied that he would still remain the verger at St. Peter Church. So he is just trying to tell us that only education is not important to determine the worth of a person. The qualities of the person, the experience that the person has gained throughout his life, all these things are equally important to make a person successful in his life. So if certain word meanings or certain phrases are not understood in this video, then I promise that I will make another video where all the word meanings will be given, where all the explanation, because I will be making another video on the RTCs, okay, on the explanation of some difficult lines of this lesson. So in that particular class you will be learning everything. So I will be ending here. I hope that you people understood what has been taught today. Okay, if you face any difficulty, you can go through the other videos also. You can learn many things there. So thank you all of you. I hope you enjoyed today's video.